So what I did was I chose Parsons. It's hard to live in New York because it's a difficult environment. There are a lot of environmental difficulties, stresses. The field itself is very difficult. I majored in illustration. So illustration is a lot of good illustrators out there, great illustrators. So the challenge for an artist, and I would imagine this is really true for all of us, is I'm going to quote a mystic poet. I'm kind of weaving different elements here because one of the greatest inspirations I had was we have our art or expression, but then there are levels and layers and layers and layers of that expression, and we can actually realize more of who we really are in that process and in that journey. And all of us, I'm going to hit a quote of a teacher of William Spartan. His quote was, I seek a world in which each would live and let, each would be valued for their own uniqueness and merit. Live and let live and reach their chosen goal of self-knowledge and God-realization. Now that sounds, why that's important is that each one of us has our own uniqueness and our own reason for being here and our merit, our value. And it's important to understand that what we're bringing through our communication is important to try to develop, to clarify it, and be gentle with that process. And it's when we're making an effort, we're going to get, I know from my life as an artist, every time I had an idea or a thought, even a prayer, the answer would come through the painting. So it's a gift, like you end up, it's like an effort, and you get grace, you get some help from somewhere, you know? The thing is to believe and know that there is something there, and there's something protecting and guiding us all the time. So as an illustrator, I was in New York, and it was a very difficult environment to live, to sort things out, you know, as an illustrator, just an artist in the city. I didn't really know what I'm going to do. But I started listening deeply to what it could be that I could say with my work, and I did connect with sports first. So I'm seeing sport-related work here, but I'm known for sports. I'm a sports illustrator. Did a lot of illustration in New York that was showed motion. I worked on the Olympics, World Cup soccer. A good story of World Cup soccer is one of the biggest pressures. I don't know if everyone has their own unique blocks and obstacles to their creative process. And one thing as an artist is always trying to unblock what's in the way of what you're trying to say. So at one point, I worked very hard. I'd go for years walking around trying to show me work to art directors. And eventually one art director remembered my work. Bless you.
Thank you.
He remembered my work, and he got to work on the whole World Cup soccer account for Spanish television in Mexico. And so he remembered me, he called me in. I didn't choose from all these other artists. And so I thought, wow, if I paid my student loan, I would be, you know, just lift up, feel like I'm free forever. I don't know what it was. So I thought at that time, this is a lot of work. I mean, this is like 60 hours a week, weeks of work. But I pulled it off, you know. All the training I got from school, I got it to the level where I honored all of that. Worked very hard, and the job was very successful. And if you look at the 86 World Cup soccer, I did the whole thing on television. But I thought like getting $13,000 was like, that was the largest amount of money I could have done. But it really wasn't. And then I found out that these guys get like $100,000 for that. So it's kind of funny. But in my way, I had to work, why I mentioned that is, we have to work where we're at, and I really came from parents that didn't have, they came from Eastern Europe, and they started with nothing, really coming here. And so I saw that the world is going forward. Everything was, I had to have a positive attitude, and money wasn't the reason why I did my work. It was a way to bring in enough so that I could do something higher. Now, I can't really take care of that unless I live a kind of ethical life. Meaning, I need to make my own living, support myself, not be dependent on it. So if we can reach that, then when we do our artwork, just like a really higher thing, writing to it, to connect something, then we can take care of ourselves, get our needs met, we're paying our rent, whatever it is, then we're gifted to allow to go to do something and connect to something that's really important in ourselves. So as an illustrator, I always had this thing between the sports, making the living, and the sports more commercial work. I did a cover for a magazine or something. And that would give me the time to work on something on other levels, work that I enjoyed myself. So a lot of what you see here are paintings connecting to nature. And I felt, after living in New York, that I wasn't as connected or happy being disconnected as much from nature. So it's our health. And I thought that was a huge important part. How our own health, and that's mentally, physically, and in spirit, is so important for us to be happy and to know who we really are. A lot of people are driven by their minds a lot, you know, they're driven that way. So empowering our minds in school is one thing, but when we're getting nourished on a creative side, we are feeling like we're connected to something much greater. So in terms of nature, one talk that my teacher gave was on living semiotically, meaning more nonviolent, meaning without hurting. Now, if we look at our world today, I have parents that are from Ukraine and I painted there. And it may seem like, you know, a pocket of something going on in the world, but for me, this is a painting kind of where my mother lived. And born in this country and then going out there, I started healing all this stuff from my childhood. It didn't make sense. I know the language and knew how to write. But when I painted out there, I connected to a lot more depth. And so the people were like, there's so much love out there that I felt as an artist I was growing even more. And so when I'm seeing what goes on in the news, I see a concept of bullying. You know, we're kids, there's some bullying, there could be bullying in the family. But the whole idea of that, living in harmony, that means that we're not separating, we're not looking for what is separating us, but looking what brings us together. And so in this area, it was so painful for me to see how people were being treated and separated by oppressive murdering dictators or whatever they are. Now, this is a bad world, you know. That's a given. But why I'm mentioning is that sometimes as an artist, you're seeing the world, your perception of what we're seeing inside ourselves is what's important. We want to connect to qualities that are human. And all the great writers, you'll see that their efforts are very keen on trying to find something within themselves. Some writing is dark, but if we're going to a higher way of thinking and writing, we could see that there is a lot that connects, and we do a lot of good with that communication. So my life as an illustrator, I have to do a lot of communication. I think there's a shopping bag I did for the New York Times around here. A lot of stuff would be printed and go out all over the country and the world, and I actually cared that nothing would come up in the bag. So that's a little story of some of my career. More of what's here, there's a residency that I did after Hurricane Sandy. This large painting was painted top of a mountain meadow. And just studies. And you connect to far more work if you go to the website. Over here, this is a cross-country trip I took to Smoky Mountains. This is painted actually in the vortex of the hurricane. The sea actually turned emerald and there were cloud formations, so you can see the sand in the painting itself. So this is, these are a little intense, being in nature that way. I live a block from the ocean in Ventnor, and it's a lot of life to be around the ocean. So on the website you'll see many, many, many seascapes. That are, of course, inspired by all the different seasons and moods of the ocean. that's something else. That's sold for triathlon. I don't know what that's for, but that's okay. Here is a forest scene in Ukraine. So I've worked with watercolor. I layer, just like we see in nature, start from the lightest color to darker color in layers. So the lightest color, you know what complementary colors are. I start with the yellow, and I go to the other end of the spectrum, violet or blue. And you keep layering like that thin. This is the way we see light in nature. So that's a layer technique. It uses watercolor, pastel, oil glazes. So this is also a landscape. This one is from Ukraine. It's at the edge of trees there. Like I said, there I received a lot more depth for some reason. That's from the jetty, Longport. A lot of these are painted on location. And again, this is an oil. I think my walk goes like starts this way and then kind of weaves around like this. So this is a church. I just painted this church. It's a Marian's church. It's an oil. I tried to isolate this from all the buildings around it. So this is a way to notice. Take notice of a building, and a lot of art does that for me. I take notice of things that people wouldn't necessarily care for. A lot of buildings are just left to be neglected. But I can appreciate the, this is all wood inside. And I brought the stone to where it would be if that church was cleaned up. So actually, when the stone reflects on this, it's golden rather than the drabby colors you see. These paintings starting here, I guess I can take you all through this way.
Oops, sorry, Steve, let me just interrupt you. Our class is initially going to be ending, so I know some of these people are going to have to get buses and things like that.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Keep taking us, you know. But
okay.
Those of you who have to, how long is the exhibit on?
I think it's on for like 3 weeks.
Okay, so if you want to come back, 9:30 to 4, is it Monday through Friday, Joyce, that you guys are open?
Yes, and 11 to 4 on Saturday.
11 to 4 on Saturday. It's free, of course, you know, so if you have time between classes and you want to come, you know, look at something a little more closely, it's also very quiet and peaceful in here, you know, if you need a break from everything, please do take advantage of the gallery here, right? Anyway, so we'll continue seeing.
Okay. And I really want to play a song for you guys because this is a great.
Oh, you guys, yeah, musicians like to do that.
Yeah, we have a musician in here. But the story through this it's kind of interesting selection of work from the past like 20 years. It's a drawing of figure to see in my cat. This would be at Sign Lake in winter. A lot of time and patience is required to layer this concord. This is of a dream reflection. Again, that media that I use allows for all these layers. I can go in there easily. Here is a mountain in the Adirondacks. Adirondack Mountains, here's a vista. A lot of these, again, are painted on location. And they connect to American painting, contemporary impressionist painting. So I was fortunate to receive a grant from the Paula Krasner Foundation. So I am in the tradition of American painters, which has a really good tradition. So you might want to, you know, look into your writers, anything you're inspired by.
We looked at some Thomas Cole in class, actually.
Oh.
We started with some Hudson River School artists, just to sort of provide some
context,
I guess. So.
Good. So I'll get to the Hudson River School. It's an interesting story. Because, see, I'm learning, I'm not anyone who really knows. We all start with very limited knowledge. And it's interesting to be part of and understand the connections. This was a commercial job, the New York Times. As a city scene. I was in Hoboken, I can't really tell you. This is an illustration that is still on this paper, so when it's actually printed it looks brilliant, but it's painted on tracing vellum on each side to give it this spatial dimension. And I, of course, you have no idea that the trade towers are going to be wiped out. This is in 85. So this was for the time. Then we had an art class we met at Parsons. We would meet at the top of the trade towers and actually paint from them. So you see these little boats. So this is a study. I used to make large paintings from there. So it is good to delve into your work. This in here is, again, going to Ukraine in the Birdcliff residency. I was in a cabin in the woods. You all can apply for these residencies. They're great. I mean, they actually give you the space to go there, if you use it that way, to really get into your work. And it's wonderful that exists. And we're in a country where one can actually develop their creative work. So there are many opportunities out there. This is a path in the forest. What's interesting is you're away from all the digital stuff. There's just basically a cabin. So it's experiential. It's just your eye, your hand, and your heart, and nature. So I'm like thinking of these, I don't have a TV right now, but I mean, I'm looking at some of these TVs and they bombard you with everything. And it's just too much, it's overload. So this is primitive, but it's very, very fulfilling, I have to say, to work this way. So painting in nature does that for me. You mentioned about the Birdcliff, I mean the Hudson River School. My dear friend, Mead Barnett, who's in the, she's in the Renaissance section of, it's an artist in Bayonne, Nova. Now, there's some real neat people that have been painting and writing a long time, and I urge you to just have a conversation with them, because they'll inspire, you know? And this, my friend actually took me to these, this is a cove, where the Hudson River School artists painted the same scene. And she knew the spots because her family is from that area. And she had generations in there. She even went to the Birdcliff, just like she was a kid running around that area. So, I mean, I don't know, I'm probably like in bliss because knowing me. But interesting thing is, a lot of the colors are started with the colors, the stones in the riverbed. If you brush a stone against another stone, you can have actually really almost a bright yellow, ochre, lavender, and a heavy earth tone from the stones, because it's shale that's been compressed from these formations that go way up into the mountains. So I'm in bliss there. Of course, I only have 6 hours to paint this, and I did a few studies. So this was painted right on location, just painting what I'm seeing, as primitive as anything. And I'm sitting in the water painting. It's real quiet there. So the American Indians would call this the grandfather, because it would show all the layers of earth and time. So they considered the area sacred. So I was very happy to be painting myself to paint. Of course, later on I slipped on some stone. But this is happy for me to connect to. Here's a vase in I was thinking of a painter, Odie Redon, who his work was visionary. If you ever look at some artists, they really deeply connect you to the spiritual place. You cannot get these colors from... So I would urge you to look at all art, because there's a wonderful history, and the world has its history. But we have our own lives and our own stories. So often our story is going to be far more enriching than... And so I would, you know, connect inside, assimilate. A lot of what we see in the world is not helping us as artists. And it takes a little courage to find some place within us that in our own healing can come from that. In fact, I'd like all of you to invite to a poetry reading that's going to be at the Arts Garage. Something outside. So here's a mystically inspired piece. And this is, I literally was working in my studio for years. I was by myself for about 12 years in the studio. But I never really feel by myself. In fact, I felt like I came more to myself then. But anyway, I was finding that for some reason, it's like, listening to the radio, I have to stay to the highest track I can listen to as a painter. And there are a lot of negative things to try to pull at an artist. So we want to listen to the highest track in ourselves. So some reason I was just getting inspiration from somewhere. I didn't know what was going on. So I mean, this is a mystically inspired piece, and I have many more like this that are inspired this way. And they're very profound pieces. I would look at an artist like Renoir, some of the Impressionists, because what they did is they interpreted the figure. They didn't just draw. They brought you into the world of, I try to do with nature. They bring the viewer and guide them to something positive. So if you spend some time with these pieces, sometimes they do, we're kind of rushing through these, but some of these pieces, a few of them actually have something to say in them. Now I urge that if you're ever in a museum or gallery, and try to see that the pieces that are more conscious, there's something there. Okay, and if you can kind of catch that, I think that's what a lot of my work is. You know, there's work that actually does say a lot, and there's work that's near more studies or. So I urge you to go to the website and actually try to find that. When I mentioned sports art, going to, actually had to get out of the city at one point, so there's a healing from that. And a lot of that is in the hospitals here in the area, through Atlantic here. I've worked on a lot of healing arts programs. And then the connection to nature. So let's see, we're going over here. This is a painting, an oil painted, inspired by the countryside of Ukraine. That's where my mother was born. And going here, you mentioned about the paintings from Fairmount Park. Yes, and those are this is 1 year, and the rest of the originals are actually in my studio, but I have a selection of studies that reflected those in here. Let's see. They have probably in my van. Anyway, I will leave those out here for you to see, because that's a whole beautiful body of work of spring. So a lot of times you'll find that the seasons, in my case, repeat and inspire. There's a lot here from autumn and late summer. Here's a mountain. This is painted on location. Christmas. This is across from the LBI Foundation. I used to teach there, and I would paint at night with the moon. I guess we have this going on now. So I would paint here a large part of the night. I'd come home really early in the morning, and we'd be painting this by moonlight. So this, you know, it's okay to be a romantic these days. This is a painting in the forest. I enjoy walking into the forest and hiking, so some of these paintings get into that forest world. And these are painted with watercolors first, see some of that in the background, and they're layered on up to water mixable oils, pastels, wax glazes. I'm using ink here, some kind of brush painting. I met friends with some Tibet, and all painted with beautiful brush set. So a lot of my work has a little bit of an oriental, some calligraphy in it, different lines and marks are made. This technique is layered from watercolor on up to, a lot of times I'll start with an ink drawing quickly. So it's drawing and painting at the same time. I know you guys are rushing out, so I do have a song. Does anybody play the guitar here or sing?
Is this just musical though, right?
You guys should all sing. No? whatever's going on, just think something. But I mentioned that because, you know, it's tough growing up in this world, I mean, or for anybody, but I mean, it is equally not an easy place. So wherever you find community, we have coffee houses near us, and we all meet and play music, and they're all ages. So I find that's important in our communities, to share story, writing, and share writing. So I'm glad for that. Maybe the hurricane brought that together for us, I don't know. But we do live in a challenging time. The back to nature idea is more about community and helping each other, because we really can't live separated very well, especially when a natural disaster comes in or something. We're really kind of on our own. So it's good to make friends while you're in school and learn as much as you can. I like the feel here in the college. It's common. And this gallery was designed by an architect. Take some care. It's quiet. It's good sound in here. So make use of whatever is here. And communities. A lot of the places, like when I was in Woodstock, they actually are starting like a sustainable way to live. Like they figure, well, a lot of things just aren't building their lives. So they're growing their own food, they're living more in a transparent kind of community. So I know this, our area in New Jersey is a bit, you know, all kind of stuff. It's not normal. I mean, you know, there's no reason why. So I mean, you just think creatively. There's always a way. So let me get my guitar out here. So glad you guys came by, because
thanks.
I have to thank the teacher for that, because he thought this is maybe of some value.
No, I think it is. I mean, we'll discuss next week too in class, guys. But I mean, I'm sure everything, you know, the artist has said, you know, that Steve has said, I'm sure you saw immediate connections to some of the philosophical discussions we've been having with the 19th century. And we didn't plan this either. We didn't talk in advance.
Good stuff. A lot of times I would be working in the studio and I'd find something to cheer me sometimes. So, you know, in the painting it's kind of quiet. But we can sing anything, but I don't know. You can email me and we can create an event here sometime. But okay, this is, again, a song I would make a painting. And then on the back of the painting, I would write, "Love has been following you." Because I felt like I got an answer through the painting. So I was just happy with what happened, you know? So our process is more reciprocal. We're on the receiving. So here we go.
Wherever you are, wherever you are.
About it and, you know, the artistic process and the essential, you you know,
just the essential nature of maintaining creativity in one's life and one's work. So
thank you. Yeah, you've got to persevere. Keep going. No, really, something is actually helping us and protecting us and guiding us, and that's true of our artwork as well. So, yeah, don't never lose faith in that. There's always something, no matter how hard it gets. And this is like 30 years of work, so I've been painting for 30 years. I've always had a roof over my head, and there were times I could have cashed in and made a lot of money as an illustrator, but there's also growth, and growth comes to us in different ways. So for me, I'm happy that with my work, I was able to go through a lot of different phases and grow and experience. It's a wonderful life. It's a wonderful journey as an artist. It may take a little patience and perseverance, and it's not for everyone. It can be difficult. Like I said, I was able to support myself a little, so I think if you can do that and then share your work, it'll inspire others.
Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. Guys, I have-